My name is Pia Hansson. I am director of the Institute of International Affairs here at the University of Iceland. For the next 4 hours, we're going to be talking about Brexit, and hopefully we're going to be looking forward. The times are challenging. I don't think anyone can deny that. But here today, we have a group of experts from the fields of academia and policy. And from you all, we expect great things. For any kind of a discussion focusing on such serious issues as Brexit, we do need all hands on deck. This conference is an example of the benefits of international cooperation. It is part of a Jean Monnet research project funded by the Erasmus Plus program. How the project came about is also an example of the necessity of working together across disciplines. Jóhanna Jónsdóttir is now the current Brexit coordinator at the Ministry for Foreign Affairs here in Iceland. But before she took up her position at the MFA, she was briefly affiliated with our institute. And that's when she wrote the application for the funds that made this possible. So thank you, Jóhanna. Her idea was to see if the experiences of Iceland, Liechtenstein and Norway might contribute to the debate of the future relationship of the UK with the EU. Before I ask Guðlaugur to take the floor, may I please ask you all to make sure to sign the attendance sheet. This is a formality we need to fulfill as part of the grant agreement. So, I actually asked Guðlaugur as well to sign, just to be sure. This is not a mailing list, so no need to worry about that. But if you'd like to be on our mailing list, that's another thing, and we'd be very happy to add you to it, of course. But now, without further ado, let me introduce to you the Minister for Foreign Affairs, Mr. Guðlaugur Þórðarson, fresh from discussions in Althingi about the third energy package, I do believe.
Actually a great place to discuss Brexit. We can say that we are in a neutral middle ground, namely the part of the European economic area outside the European Union. Through the EEA agreement, Iceland, Norway and Liechtenstein are able to trade freely on the internal market and participate in other areas of mutually beneficial cooperation. This year, the 25th anniversary of the EEA agreement has given us an opportunity to look back and see how the agreement has worked for us here in Iceland. While the EEA is not perfect, it strikes a balance for Icelanders who in general do not want to join the EU, but at the same time seek close cooperation with the EU member states. For Iceland, it has brought opportunities and fostered prosperity without us having to join policies of the EU which do not suit our economy or approach, like the common agriculture and fisheries policies. The EFTA states are also free to make free trade agreements with whom they wish and have actually been very successful in that regard. To me, this freedom to trade lies at the heart of Brexit. I have been following UK policies closely for decades, and the original Brexit lie in the quest for more freedom, not less. We all know that when it came to the Brexit campaign and the referendum, less liberal policies got in the mix and had a great impact on the outcome. But we should keep in mind where the idea of Brexit comes from. I have often been asked if Iceland would welcome the UK into the EEA, and I have always remained open to exploring that option. While it seems that this option is off the table, at the moment at least, the EEA agreement at least offers some important insights into the debate given its success. I think we can all agree that practical solutions are what we need right now. The reality is that unless something unexpected happens, the UK will leave the EU in 2 months, whether there is a deal or no deal. The future relationship between the UK and the EU will need to be negotiated, and it's important to get that right. There's a lot at stake, not just for UK and the EU, but for other close partners and friends, such as Iceland. I'm an optimist at heart. I think it's possible for the UK and the EU to build a new, mutually beneficial partnership. And that, my friends, is why you are here today, to explore possible solutions to this important challenge. We are all extremely lucky that we live in times of peace and prosperity. European countries are close friends and trading partners today, and it's easy to forget that it wasn't always the case. The EU has played a significant role in this vital development, and I respect and acknowledge that. That being said, a membership of the EU is not right for everyone. We should be able to find ways to allow trade, cooperation and friendship to continue without everyone having to fit into the same boat. I know it's difficult to detangle a relationship which has been developing along a certain path for almost half a century. This has never been done before. I am convinced it can work, especially if negotiators on both sides show creativity, flexibility and goodwill towards each other. People often talk about Brexit as a divorce. That automatically conjures feelings of animosity and dispute, which can cloud our judgment. At this hour, it is important for all involved to remember the strong bonds that tie us together and the advantages that a good solution would generate. Those who know me know that I'm a big football fan. So I prefer to use a football analogy instead. We have a national leagues and we have the World Cup. Brexit must drive us to work together for a common solution. Much like a national team, where rivals become allies. We must be resourceful enough to find a way to play together to achieve optimal results. In a time when free trade and liberal values like human rights and democracy is under threat, it is imperative that like-minded states stand united to defend our common values. So let's play some beautiful, dynamic and fast-paced football to ensure that we never walk alone. The ambassador of the UK is not pleased with my final words. Gave me a sign, so very pleased, the Liverpool sign, until I turned it, flipped it around, so it was said made in Everton. It says it all. But now I'd like to introduce the man who is one of our team, which is going to see to us everything will be alright for Iceland and UK after Brexit, Ambassador Stefán Ríkharðsson.
Seminar which will deal with the areas that are likely to form part of the EU-UK future relationship, looking specifically at customs arrangements and internal market, namely goods, services, capital and people. And we have with us a list of excellent experts that, and I feel extremely privileged to have this role and to be here today and to be able to listen to what they will say here today. And I'm sure that we will all hang on all the words you are gonna say here today. And I must say, your sense of timing is excellent. You are here today at a time in the Brexit saga which has hardly been more interesting. So we will start with the three presentations. First, we will start with a presentation on the state of play regarding the future EU-UK relationship. And who better than Hugo Brady, advisor and speechwriter to Donald Tusk, president of the European Council, to shed a light on that. And I believe the country he actually knows best is actually Ireland, so I'm sure he has some perceptions from that side as well. After Hugo, Sam Lowe, who is a senior research fellow at the Center for European Reform, which is a highly respected think tank, he will deal with what kind of future relationship with the EU does UK want, and I'm sure he knows very well and can answer that question. And finally, we will have Larissa Brunner. She is a policy analyst at the European Policy Center, which is also a very well respected think tank. And she will address the question, is the EU's position on cherry picking set in stone? After they have done their presentations, we will have a panel with Maximilian Conrad. He is head of department and professor in political science at the University of Iceland. Henry Haggard, chief of staff of the United Mission to the European Union, and he will no doubt give us some insights into the US perceptions on the Brexit saga. And finally, last and not least, Baroness Julie Smith, reader in European politics at the University of Cambridge. So we will start with the presentations. After that, we will I will ask the panel to come up, say a few words, each of them, and then we will open up for questions and discussion. So if I may ask you, Hugo, to start the presentations. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Ambassador. Thank you also to the Foreign Minister for saying those nice words. I liked his analogy of the football field, because a football field is also, of course, a level playing field. And that needs to guide us if we're going to have a dynamic and exciting relationship in the years ahead. Also, indeed, you are right, Ambassador, I am Irish, but I would like to assure you that the Irish backstop is not the sole genius of me, although I am actually from the border area. In fact, I have, with Tusk, what I try and do there is simply guide him about the politics of Northern Ireland. That's a bit of a mystery to people, because I'm from the region. But I am not the power. There is a unionist member of the House of Lords who keeps claiming that the reason why Donald Tusk is pushing the Irish backstop is because he has an Irish Republican army. You have no idea, John. It's John Taylor, who is a former leader of the unionists. How much I've wanted to, at night when I've had a few too many glasses of wine, reach for that phone and open the Twitter and went, just put it down. Although sometimes we do have to rest and phone off the president. But I think he said something, if you remember when England was playing Iceland, he was, unfortunately, I think he was a situation like that. And then he tweeted out, winter is coming. And these were the times when we could laugh about Brexit a little bit, but unfortunately And I spoke here, and I really enjoyed the energy. I love Iceland as well, by the way. I come back here all the time. And I'm super fascinated by the Nordic Hiberno roots of the settlement. So if anybody has information on that or is also passionate about that, I would be very delighted to talk to you. Because it's a real hobby of mine. I'm not kidding. I'm very interested in it. But let me start, because this is not one of these typical lectures, but only a 15-minute presentation. It's my job really to orientate you just with where we are, how we got here, which is always very tiresome, but it'll help frame the debate. And on the Irish backstop, you can ask all the questions you want to a neutral expert, and one of the best experts there is out there, Sam Lowe, later on. So, of course, there was a referendum in the UK, an advisory referendum on leaving the EU, and it was narrowly won by the Leave side. Then it was 52-48, if you remember, we had a nice discussion about that the last time I spoke about it. Then about a year later, less than a year later, the UK triggered Article 50. I was there when the ambassador handed over the letter to Tusk. And then we began our preparations. Well, we had begun our preparations before then, and we agreed within ourselves, the EU27, that we have to settle the legacy issues of membership before we can move on to the future relationship. So this is where our story begins today. That basically, I know you want to talk about the future relationship, but seeing as we are into a very difficult situation where Britain could leave in 60 days without a deal, unfortunately this issue is going to come back over and over again of what to do about the three issues that are covered in the withdrawal agreement. And they are settling Britain's budgetary payments to the EU budget, £39 billion as I remember. Secondly, guaranteeing the rights of EU27 citizens in Britain and guaranteeing the rights of British citizens in the EU27. It's trickier than you think, and it's the most important priority because these are actual human beings at stake and their lives at stake. I must say, on a personal note, and everything I say today is personal, by the way, I'm not Tusk himself, only one of his advisors. It makes me so sad that these people are living in maximum uncertainty. And even my own sister, who lived in the UK for 14 years, and was asking me, will I be able to stay? But so we have to find a resolution for them as quickly as we can. And in our view, the most best, justiciable, solid way to do that is to get the withdrawal agreement ratified that we both, the UK and the EU27, signed last November. Of course, the major sticking point of that agreement seems to be the Irish backstop. And we are currently waiting for proposals from the UK government, which the Prime Minister has promised us, that will offer an alternative to the backstop that achieves the same effect. And the effect is to ensure there is no hard border on the island of Ireland. When I was 10 years old, I used to cross the border in Northern Ireland all the time, and you would have these British soldiers and lots of infrastructure just kind of surveil the whole surrounding countryside. And the violence in the Northern Ireland conflict was always worse around the border. So this is why there's a fear that if you erect border infrastructure, it will become a target for militants. And you know, Northern Ireland has no government at the moment and has not had one since more or less the referendum. And you have two communities who must live together in order to do business together. And the tensions are rising in that community. I mean, with Northern Ireland, you just never know what's going on really. But we do see an uptick of some sectarian violence. And I can assure you, Northern Ireland, it's not a problem until it suddenly is. So what we need to do is protect the legacy of 20 years of peace under the Good Friday Agreement. And the EU, believe it or not, is sincere about making it the third condition of the withdrawal agreement, because the EU sees itself as a peace project. The EU is unbelievably, almost sweetly, absolutely sincere about that self-image. Sometimes, by the way, I think it's too naive. But there's a very strong self-perception of the European Union as a peace project. And because of the introduction of the single market in 1992, that's when the customs post came down. And although the peace wasn't signed until 7 years later, really the European Union deserves a lot of credit it never got for creating the idea that peace was inevitable. Because for the nationalist community, they believe they live in one country. And there is no greater expression of that for them than to go across the border without being checked. And by the way, the UK soldiers were always very nice to my mummy. So, you know, it's not that I have some big issue about that. We believe the UK, because the Article 50 is 2 years in duration, we believe the UK will be leaving the European Union this March. However, because the withdrawal agreement was not passed in the House of Commons, we get two extensions requested by the UK to see if it could be done. I'm sorry, this June is a mistake. It was actually April we agreed that. This is a timeline I did of the UK Prime Minister is making my job very hard because yesterday he changed everything, proroguing Parliament, he will try and do that so that Parliament will in fact not meet until right up at the key European Council, where most people now believe there will be a very sort of very, very difficult discussion to see if we can try and avoid this terrible outcome of no deal, because no deal is a big deal, if you know what I mean. It's not some small thing, and what's so strange to me about Brexit is how this narrow referendum, an advisory referendum, went from, okay, we're going to leave the EU but stay in the single market, which is the sort of initial position, and many leavers, key leavers were saying, then somehow that morphed into, okay, of course if we stay in the single market, we're not really leaving the EU, so we have to leave the single market as well. And then that suddenly became, the only real way to get out of the Europeans what we want out of them is to leave with no deal at all, and make sure that they know that. So it's this radicalisation of opinion on this matter, and it's quite mysterious to me how it got there so quickly. Because, and here's my one thing, one message today I want to put into your minds about the future relationship. Let's imagine everything I just said there is, we're going to find a way. Boris Johnson is a political genius, Tusk is a political genius, we will find a way to get rid of all these problems, and at the last minute, like the EU always does, you will read this headline and then you'll go, what did I worry about that for? Well, fine. Then we get on to discussing the future relationship. And I can tell you, it will be the first free trade agreement in history that loosens rather than tightens economic ties. As we're in that weird position with Brexit. What does a hard Brexit actually mean? Well, you can't have integrated supply chains or just-in-time deliveries if you have to do checks at the border. And that's what you will have to do if you're in a different customs arrangement to the European Union, which is what hard Brexit sort of means, and if you're in a different regulatory environment. Another thing is we won't be able to have the same financial integration that we've had in the past. The City of London, with its vast, deep resources, is actually the banker for the Eurozone area. So that can't continue because it won't be, if it's out of the single market, we won't have passporting, and therefore we won't really be able to do the same level of, for example, all the euro clearing that happens in the Eurozone area more or less goes through the City of London. I'm not pretending it's not an issue for us also, it is, because there's very few places in the world that have the depth in financial services provision that can replace the UK's role. There would be a loss of access overnight to 43 trade deals that the European Union has. And if the hard Brexit tears, if their disagreement with the EU was that we are not aggressive enough on trade, then the last 3 years have really shown that is not really true. In the last 3 years, the EU has signed free trade deals with Singapore, Mercosur, Mexico, Vietnam, Canada. We're in talks with Australia, New Zealand. So we're actually the last man standing in world trade because, as you know, between America and China and in the World Trade Organization, things are not looking very, very healthy for world trade. But the EU is still out there, still doing market opening. And it's almost as important to us as our identity as a peace project, is our identity as a global free trading entity. I just put this note here about no deal, but at the same time that we agreed, or around the same time we agreed the withdrawal agreement, we started laying out what the EU thinks the future relationship will roughly look like. And these are the categories that we think will sort of just, this is the way we frame the thinking on the matter. First is our economic partnership, which will dictate how orientated we are towards each other. It's probably the most important part, and I'll talk about that a bit more in a second. The second, and everybody misses this, is the law enforcement cooperation side. The EU has an incredibly deep regime for police and judicial cooperation through the European arrest warrant, the European evidence warrant, basically 10, 15 years of gradual but revolutionary integration in this area. And it's made a huge difference in fighting organised crime and terrorism. So we would both be very interested in staying in a relationship with each other on that. However, we simply cannot do that unless you have a relationship with the European Court of Justice, because it's the European Court of Justice that arbitrates the whole human rights elements of that and so on. So it's very hard for me to see how we'll be able to maintain the same level of efficiency as regards things like extradition. It's going to get worse, basically, not better. Third is foreign policy, in which the UK is obviously a very, very important player as a member of the Security Council and so on. But the political declaration is clear, we will not be taking joint decisions together. We will take our decisions and then we will try and coordinate with the with Britain as much as we can. For example, on sanctions, which is very important that we work together on things like that. Security and defence, something similar. France, which has a very privileged relationship with the UK on security and defence matters, will certainly want to see a framework of cooperation continue with the UK on that. Of course, the UK remains a member of NATO and so on and so on. So the EU's identity in this area is quite small, I must say, and humble, but it is growing slowly on things like civilian crisis management. Then there's research. And of course, the EU, it's an unsung success of the EU is the European Research Council. There's a most international organizations, you know, whatever you get in, you have to get something out for your country. But the European Research Council works strictly on merit. And in fact, the two largest receivers of EU, of FP7 money in the EU are Oxford and Cambridge. That'll show you, because it's just based on who's the best. We've managed to depoliticize those grants. And seriously, look at, if anyone's interested in that, it's an unsung success of European policy in the last couple of years. The last is data protection, I think we all know. So vital to our civic, economic, and personal security now. So if we can find a common ground with the UK on that matter, I think it's really essential. Now I'm sure you've seen this before, this is what is known as the Barnier staircase. And apologies to anyone who's sick of looking at it. But this is how the trading relationship will be defined. And it's very easy to summarise. Basically, the best access you can get economically to Europe is through EU membership. The second best access you can get is through the EEA. And Iceland is one of the few countries I know. UK Prime Minister is famously pro-cake and pro-having it. And I think this is the only category where you can actually have that in this relationship. So well done to your diplomats and politicians over the years who skillfully hammered out that relationship for you. Switzerland has a slightly different relationship. It left the EEA, so it, like yourselves, can do its own free trade deals, and it has bilateral deals with us on everything else we hate, sort of thing. Ukraine is a country we care about, so we gave it an extra special trade deal. But actually, Ukraine is very interested in being as close to the EU as possible, so it's not an issue. The UK, as your foreign minister said, Brexit for the UK is freedom. And freedom is the least free. For me, it's the other way around, but that's okay. And this, for the Brexiteers, is the most free. Or maybe this, okay? So that's what we worry a little bit, is that that's actually the destination point. What does this whole, summarise this whole graph quickly? Very simple. You can have the best possible access, but that comes with the most strings. We don't see them as strings. In fact, it's a good thing. What I think the many Brexiteers would like is all the benefits of this with the responsibilities of that. So the problem with that is that our free trade agreements with Canada, they're good, very good, but they mostly only cover goods. And when you consider that most of the UK's economy is service-based, as is the European economy, that's a big problem for our future relationship. It means that, we might have tariff-free access on for goods, but goods are a sort of small and increasing part of our economic relationship, so what about the rest? And I think this is, if we do get there past the withdrawal agreement drama, I think it's just some more data, then we would be, this would be the big issue. I mean, how can you get, you know, this is not an appropriate relationship for, you can do the best free trade deal with the United States of America in the world, but it will never substitute for the amount of trade you do with your neighbours, the so-called gravity model of trade. The UK ambassador can contradict me, but I think there is a statistic that says that Britain trades by volume as much more with Ireland than it does with China. Another nice statistic I heard, I don't want to get into energy issues with Iceland. A very good guy on Newsnight in Britain, he tried to explain what a no-deal Brexit means, and he said, look, we are connected to the Europeans by pipes and wires. Even Churchill said the same. He said, I'd love to take Britain and drag it across the ocean to America, but no one's found a way of doing that. thank you. So the issue is basically, no matter if you do the best free trade, fanciest free trade deal in the world in Singapore, which the EU has, you will never be connected to Singapore by pipes and wires. You know, we can't escape each other, I'm afraid, and that's why I'm so passionately pro-European, because it's a rather decentralised way of learning to live together. I will stop there, because I don't know why I put that there. It just means there could be an no-deal Brexit in Halloween.
Make all of your own rules, because in the areas where we can make our own rules, we already do. If you think
think about the most restrictive, most economically restrictive regime within the UK right now, probably the planning system, and that's got nothing to do with the EU. So we could change that now if we wanted to. But in the areas where, of trade where we do maybe want to make our own rules, we're not necessarily going to be able to, but we can decide to try and more greatly integrate with one of the other regulatory superpowers, to pivot towards the US in certain areas. And you see this in the Brexit discourse, where at the beginning of Brexit, free trade agreements weren't really talked about that much. But now if you speak to people who advocate for Brexit, particularly no-deal Brexit, their biggest prize is a trade agreement with the US. And in some ways, this is symbolic. You want something to put on the mantelpiece. You want something to hold above your head. But also, they see it as not necessarily even a means to an end. It's a means of reorientating the British economy away from European approaches towards US approaches. And I'm trying not to sort of make any judgment on this. This is just true of some people advocating. And the issue the UK has is that extrication from the EU system does come with an economic cost. And it's also in the US's interest to get as much from the UK as possible in any future trade agreement, and for the UK to concede on all of the issues that the EU has failed to concede on in their discussions with the US, because for the US it's bigger than the UK. When you're regulatory superpowers and you're competing, getting a foothold in Europe via the UK is something bigger than the trade agreement with the UK itself. It gives you a regulatory foothold in Europe, it gives you an ally when it comes to advocating for different approaches, but these consequences for the UK are real. So let's take one of my favourite issues to talk about, so sanitary and phytosanitary issues. So this is food hygiene. If the EU system on food hygiene is very binary, and Iceland is within it via the EEA agreement, so if you are inside the EU's SPS regime, you can trade products of animal origin freely across the borders. If you're Iceland, you might have some customs issues, but that's not to do with the regulatory issues, that's to do with being outside of the customs union. But if you want to sell into the EU from outside as a third country a product of animal origin, first you have to have your country recognised as some way able to do it, then different factories, facilities have to be recognised, but then once you've got through all of that, you have the documentation ready, it has to enter the EU via a veterinary border inspection post for a specific type of port of entry, where it's subject to 100% document checks, 100% identity checks, and up to 50% physical inspections. You can reduce the physical inspection rate by agreement, as New Zealand has done. And the problem for the UK here is that if we want to concede to the EU's demands on sanitary and phytosanitary issues, which there are many and they will be made, then we have to be outside of the EU's SPS regime. And that means all of our exports of animal origin are subject to these controls upon entry. And this is a trade-off. That is going to be difficult for British farmers, and it's actually going to be slightly annoying for Iceland as well, in that the UK, I know you use as a land bridge when it comes to some of your live fish, but also you've used the UK in the past to process your fish to essentially get round tariffs that would have been subject to being levied if they were processed here in Iceland. And the issue you have here, have there, is your products are going to get caught up with all of these checks as well. I know the Icelandic industry is prepared for this, and you've found other processors in other bits of the UK, of Europe, and you're going to be fine, I'm sure. But these consequences are far reaching. And the other issue we have here is that if the UK is to pivot, you have the Northern Ireland question. Can you fully extricate yourself from the EU's regulatory regime and have an open border in Northern Ireland? The answer, to my mind, is no, you can't. If you have extricated yourself from the EU's regulation regime, there are going to be controls, particularly on products of animal origin, and then this, if you go to customs issues as well, you have concerns there, although they're potentially a bit easier to deal with. But this is a problem, because you also have the issue from the US, where you now have this caucus of Congress people who say they will not do a trade agreement with the UK if it threatens the Good Friday Agreement. Yet it's also Congress's demands on USTR that they negotiate on agriculture, that they negotiate on food standards, that have created this problem in the first place. So even on the US side, there are these contradictions, these trade-offs that maybe haven't been fully articulated. And then the other issue of this pivot is that I'm just talking about trade, but it's always more than trade. Trade is one part of your relationship with other countries. And as we saw with the John Bolton visit to the UK recently, the trade agreement is a carrot. In terms of what John Bolton, the National Security Advisor to Donald Trump, particularly wants, its greater UK alignment on bigger issues such as Huawei, China, Iran. And the UK might feel more alignment with those issues on those issues with the US anyway, so that's a possibility. Also, it might not. It has taken differing positions in the past and is aligned with Europe on these issues, and these will be conditions. So it's a big decision to make. And then there's also this question of the popularity of the pivot. Where is this constituency for this pivot in the UK? Who likes free trade, even, is an interesting question to ask the UK. If you ask the British population, do you like free trade, if everyone says yes. If you frame it in terms of trade-offs, they instantly sound very French. It's a process of discovering that we're quite European after all. And then you have the issue that the people who are most pro-free trade tended to vote Remain and now associate any agreement with the US as being to do with Brexit. So you have this difficulty. But this is where you get to the question of no deal. Because to my mind, if you do want this rupture, if you do want this pivot, one of the only ways of creating the conditions necessarily to deliver it is no deal. And the reason I say that is that a trade agreement with the US, in terms of the trade-offs it poses for Britain, is not necessarily very popular. But the British population do believe that a trade agreement with the US can offset the economic losses of Brexit. This isn't based on any evidence, but it's just based on perception, but there's quite a lot of polling that shows this to be true. So the argument that we have left the EU and we have had an economic rupture, and the US functions as an economic life raft, is potentially politically salient. And the other reason a rupture is, I think, necessary in order to perform this pivot is there are huge sunk costs associated with no deal. So if we are outside of the EU's SPS regime, as we would be in no deal, all of these controls enter into effect. The marginal cost of further divergence is actually very small. So conceding to the US's demands in that instance doesn't necessarily cost your farmers any more because they've already been hit very, very hard. And the other issue, I suppose the question mark that lingers over all of this is Northern Ireland. What do you do about Northern Ireland? And my feeling is that even in the event of no deal, the discussions on Northern Ireland continue, and you ultimately end up with Northern Ireland-specific arrangements, even if not truly in name. In fact, the UK's no deal plans for Northern Ireland involve Northern Ireland being treated differently from the rest of the UK. This is something that I feel is underappreciated in the UK debate. But then, so there's this question, so I suppose those are the choices, the decisions, but where does all of this end up? So let's take, I asked Twitter about this, I said, well, in 15 years' time, what do people think the UK-EU relationship looks like? And 90% of the responses were, don't you mean the EU-England relationship? So there's this big assumption that no deal leads to the breakup of the UK, and there is a fear. My perception is no deal makes a united Ireland more likely, and it makes it more difficult for the Scots to leave. The economic costs of leaving the Union to Scotland actually increase exponentially for outside of the EU. The EU is very good actually for localisation because it creates a framework from within which everyone can exist without having to argue about who makes the rules after we've left. The who makes the rules question within the UK becomes quite a big one. But my answer to what does it look like in 15 years, and this is just me guessing, this is speculation, is I think the UK ends up in a relationship economic-wise, quite similar to Switzerland. I think in 15 years' time or so, that's roughly where it lands. So very integrated on goods, less so on services. I think this comes with its own institutional architecture, and there's a panel later talking about what the institutional architecture looks like, but I think it will be interesting to look at how the EU-Swiss institutional agreement works, if and when it's ratified and brought into effect, because I think that could set a precedent for what this looks like. And why do I think that's where we ultimately end up? I think answer one, regulatory gravity. The UK is in the EU's regulatory sphere. While we may wish to diverge in certain areas, the fact that we actually have a land border with the EU, the fact that we are on its doorstep, means that businesses will continue to align their means of production and lobby for alignment, even if the EU government would prefer divergence in certain areas. And after a while, it becomes beneficial to say, well, we're aligned anyway, we may as well lock in the benefits. Or all of the benefits, and that comes from a close relationship. The other reason I think that ultimately we end up with a closer relationship than maybe it looks like now is that at some point there will be a different government. And the moment there is, it's not necessarily even a Labour government, it might just be a different type of Conservative government, and the moment that happens, they will seek a closer relationship with the EU. And I think some of the people who advocate no deal do know this, which is why they're trying to get as far away as possible now, because it means that you can only go back so far. And the other reason I think that it's potentially where we end up is that there is still scope for limited autonomy on trade. I think, as I've said throughout this, I think Northern Ireland has a slightly separate relationship in the end, which probably does involve customs union as well. But Switzerland can do its own trade agreement, so can Iceland. You both have trade agreements with China. They're not very good trade agreements, if I'm just speaking quietly, but they exist. I mean, they're a bit slightly lopsided, but they exist, and they try and sign them because it is geopolitically in China's interest to do so. The UK could potentially do the same. It's a big question of the US, because could the US do a stripped down trade agreement with the UK, with Iceland, with Switzerland, with Norway, that didn't include agriculture or not to the extent they wanted? Yes, they could theoretically, but politically that's a difficulty on the US side, but that could change if the US starts to approach Europe a bit more geopolitically rather than based on the agricultural lobby in Congress. And then the other reason I think we ultimately end up fairly aligned is Northern Ireland. Just going back to this. If we don't want Northern Ireland to separate, and I'm a unionist, and this is why I support the backstop, I think the best way of ensuring Northern Ireland stays in part of the UK is to ensure that you do not disrupt that border. So I think the moment you do, and the moment you disrupt it for everyday people, I think the question of United Ireland goes up the agenda. And I think, hopefully, people in Westminster will agree with, which they don't at the moment, seem just to be keen to play fast and loose with that border. But I suppose the issue here is this could take a very long while to get to. And actually, the getting to this process, so 15, 20 years, could be very, very messy indeed. And it impacts our relationship with the EU, because it also impacts our relationship with Iceland and with the other periphery, the other countries on the periphery of the EU. As we've seen, I know Iceland and the UK have this continuity agreement. That means that people in the UK assume that in the event of no deal, the relationship with Iceland would continue as they did before. It would on tariffs, but little more beyond that. I think this is known here in Iceland, it's not known in the UK. People assume that this is going to be continuity as it exists now, whatever the case, because it's been badly and poorly advertised by the British government. But I will stop there, and I think the main thing I'm trying to get across here is the UK does have choices to make. We don't know what it's going to decide to do just yet, but there are trade-offs inherent to those, just as, going back to independent people, sovereignty or full autonomy for you as yourself does come with a cost. That is true of the UK just as it was and is for Iceland. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much for inviting me here to Iceland. It's a great pleasure to be here. So the question I'm going to look at is whether the EU's position on cherry picking is set in stone. And EU concerns about UK cherry picking are not new in any way. And indeed, there have been the EU has been worried about this throughout the Brexit process, really. And the sometimes rather mixed signals it has been getting from the UK government in its various compositions haven't really helped. And however, the issue has received renewed attention in recent weeks, thanks to the letter that Prime Minister Boris Johnson sent to European Council President Donald Tusk, where he basically says that the point of Brexit is for the UK to be able to diverge from EU rules and standards. And at this point, I'd kind of like to clarify what I mean by cherry picking. And Hugo has already showed it with his nice diagram and the Barnier steps. So what I mean by cherry picking is basically wanting the benefits of a particular arrangement, for example, wanting the benefits of full EU membership, but the responsibilities of something else, so the responsibilities of Canada. And I do not mean wanting some sort of tailor-made or bespoke trade arrangement, because any trade deal between the EU and the UK would have to be tailor-made and bespoke, because it's a very unique situation, it's a very So very unique circumstances. So that's not what I'm talking about. I am talking about wanting full market access, but not wanting to comply with EU rules and standards, for example. And for the EU, four areas here are particularly important. State aid, environmental standards, labour and social standards, and taxation. And now I want to ask the question, why would the EU care if the EU, if the UK suddenly wanted to lower all its standards and cut taxes and give out loads of state aid to companies? It does care for a few reasons, because so first the EU is worried that that might undermine its own competitiveness, because in the most extreme scenario, they fear that the UK could move away from the European economic and social model and move towards a more mercantilist, a more low tax, low regulation, US style model. And that would then make the UK much more attractive to investors from outside the area. And if then some EU member states felt that they had to follow suit and also lower their own standards to maintain their competitiveness, that could lead to a regulatory race to the bottom. And that is something that the EU really wants to avoid. But one could argue, surely that has to be, surely that is a problem in other trade relations too. So why can't the EU just use existing approaches? Would that not be enough? And the short answer here is no, it's not enough. There are some mechanisms to prevent regulatory races to the bottom and to maintain certain standards, but they do not account for the specificities of this situation. So for example, if we look at state aid, there are WTO rules on state aid, but they only cover goods and not services. And as we've just seen, services account for around 80% of the UK's GDP and for around 40% of the UK's exports to the rest of the EU, so you can see why that would be a bit of a problem. Non-regression clauses, so clauses in trade agreements that basically say that the two parties can't lower their standards below a certain level in order to increase their competitiveness, often have quite weak implementation and enforcement, so that's not really great either. And international frameworks such as OECD frameworks or the rules set by the International Labour Organization tend to be a lot less stringent than EU rules, so that's not really appropriate either. And that leads me to my next question. How likely is it actually that the UK is going to diverge substantially from the EU? And I think it's a valid question, that it's not the point in this context. And I'll start with why it's a valid question. Because I don't think that it is actually very likely that we would see a huge UK divergence in the foreseeable future, because first, there's I see some people shaking their heads, so I mean that's my argument. You can maybe in the panel session you can you can tell us why you disagree with that. But I would argue that there's at the moment no indication that existing policy preferences are going to change radically overnight. So if the new government were to try and change the existing economic model radically and, for example, move to a low tax, low regulation kind of Singapore and Thames economy, then it would probably encounter quite significant resistance. Second, I would argue that the UK government has financial and also non-financial capacity constraints. It simply cannot really afford to give out loads of state aid to companies, to individual companies or industries. And also, in terms of capacity constraints, Brexit dominates the political debate to such an extent that there is, I think, simply very little time and energy and sort of mental capacity left to focus on other ambitious reforms to restructure the entire country and the economy. So I think, Parliament to implement such ambitious reforms that would also be very controversial, I think is quite limited. And third, existing legal and economic structures always create some sort of inertia, and to change that, especially in such uncertain times, might be, again, a bit difficult. But, so you could argue that basically this whole question is basically just a lot of much ado about nothing, but as I alluded to earlier, for the EU that's not the point, because for the EU the point is not so much what is likely to happen, but what could happen, because the EU27 would not be willing to build a free trade agreement that is supposed to be permanent and supposed to last until it is renegotiated on the assumption that the UK is really quite unlikely to diverge significantly. They will want to have some hard commitments that can bind future governments. So the next question is, what is standing in the way of such hard commitments? And there are sort of three sets of reasons. And the first set of reasons relates to sovereignty and principles, because the principle of sovereignty implies that the UK should be able to set its own rules in principle. And I mean, that's the whole Brexit narrative, this whole taking back control narrative. And it should be able to do so as long as it doesn't interfere with fair competition, even if it means that the UK gets a competitive advantage from doing so. And moreover, the UK's point of view is that unless that basically special level playing field provisions are only justified if the UK gets a special trade relationship with the EU that goes beyond what other third countries would get. If it doesn't get that, then from the UK's point of view, special provisions would not be justified. So in other words, as Theresa May put it, the UK could not accept basically the obligations of Norway and the rights of Canada. The second set of reasons relates to crafting those provisions, because it's not entirely straightforward. So the first question would be how to differentiate unfair measures and legitimate public policy, because you could easily imagine how, for example, legitimate public policy measures, for example, cutting red tape to support structurally weak areas that might be hit very hard by Brexit, potentially giving companies subsidies to build factories in those areas, how they also have an impact on competitiveness. And distinguishing the two can be quite difficult. The second sub-point would be heterogeneity, because in the EU, there is the legal framework is quite patchy in some areas. In other areas, you have EU directives basically only specify minimum and maximum levels. So for example, if you look at minimum wages, there is no EU-wide minimum wage. So there is the assumption that some heterogeneity is okay. And it can even be okay to have some distortions if they allow poorer countries or poorer regions to catch up. So in the case of the UK, it's a bit difficult because UK standards tend to be fairly high and higher than the standards in some other European countries. So do you then basically tell the UK that it can't lower its standards under basically below the level they're currently at? Or does it mean that you tell the UK that that it can't lower its standards below the minimum level required for the EU? Because those two are very different things. If you go with the first approach, then you basically ask the UK to maintain higher standards than some EU member states. If you go with a second approach, then in principle the UK could lower its labour standards to the level that, I can't really think of a good example, but let's say some Eastern European country has. So that's potentially quite problematic too. And the third sub-point is the question of dynamic alignment. So what happens if the UK increases its standards? Would the UK have to follow suit? If yes, that would basically make the UK a rule taker, which I'm sure you can imagine would be politically extremely difficult in the UK. Raise all sorts of questions. If not, then there's the risk that you would get accidental divergence over time, simply if the EU moves forward and the UK basically today I'd like to talk about reciprocity, because if you have those level playing field provisions, then you have to make them reciprocal. So you have to basically also allow the UK to challenge regressions on part of the EU. But if you do that, then you suddenly give the UK a lot of power over EU policy making, which perhaps not all EU member states might welcome. So that's for the EU, that's another point to consider. So the EU and the UK have still come up with something, and basically they've agreed a blueprint for level playing field provisions in the context of the withdrawal agreement. So on state aid, they basically agreed that during the transition period and under the backstop agreement, under the backstop arrangement, EU rules will continue to apply. On environmental, labour and social standards, they've basically agreed non-regression clauses, which have all sorts of weaknesses, as I've just outlined. But they basically mean that those standards basically can't fall below the level they are at the end of the transition period. And taxation is much more difficult because it really touches on sovereignty questions. So the measures are a lot less ambitious than in other areas. The EU and the UK basically commit to implementing the principles of good governance, including OECD and other international standards. Also, the UK is going to transpose into domestic law several EU directives on reporting and on administrative cooperation. But that's pretty much it for now. So, in an ideal world, the EU-UK FTA will then build on the commitments that the two parties have made in the withdrawal agreement. And as Sam pointed out earlier, we will need some institutional arrangements, so that would also be a big part of the negotiations. There would have to be a measure, a way to deal with dispute settlement. But also, as I'm sure you know, there's no guarantee that everything is going to go well. And basically, problems are going to could arise under two scenarios. First, if there's a no-deal Brexit. And second, if the UK government wanted to revisit some of the level playing field provisions in the context of the trade agreement. And in the case of the no-deal Brexit, of course, if the UK leaves without the withdrawal agreement, then it is not bound by the rules. It means it's not necessarily bound by the level playing field rules, which means that if there's an acrimonious divorce, it can basically, there might be some desire to retaliate. And those desires the UK could be pushed a bit further in that area if it faces economic pressures, and also if there are quite difficult negotiations with third countries for trade deals, as we've just heard in the case of US food safety standards, for example. So to answer the question that I asked at the beginning of whether the EU's position on cherry picking is set in stone, not necessarily. But what I would say is set in stone is the EU's desire to protect its fundamental principles and to protect its economic and social model. And to do that, it has to prevent the UK from undermining it through cherry picking in those areas. One way of doing so is through level playing field provisions, but as I've outlined, it's by no means straightforward. And if there's a no-deal Brexit scenario, then the EU might even struggle to convince the UK to agree to that. Thank you very much.
Well, I'd like to thank the three speakers, Hugo, Sam and Larissa, for their excellent addresses and presentations. And I'm sure there are a lot of questions popping up in your minds. But before that, let's move on to the panelists and move on to the panel discussion. So I'd like to ask the three panelists to take a seat here at the table, and also the speakers. if they could do that as well. We have a seat for all of you. Issues we are addressing in this segment, the scope of the EU-UK relationship, and if you have any reactions to the comments made by the three speakers, we would highly welcome that as well. So if I may ask and start with Maximilian Conrad, if he wants to break the ice on behalf of the other panelists. Maximilian, go ahead.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. I recall that maybe half a year ago we had a similar event like this on a much, much smaller scale, but with Hugo Brady as well. And what strikes me when I hear his presentation is that, well, essentially the question that I'm asking myself for, that I've been asking myself for maybe the last 2 years, or maybe even since the referendum, AMN, of course, as a political scientist, we're always interested in understanding the logics of what makes people behave the way they do. But what also strikes me in this context is how little actually seems to be changing objectively. And because I mean, we're also in this project, in this project about lessons from the EEA countries for the Brexit process, and we've essentially been asking ourselves the question of, are there lessons to learn from the EEA experience? And is the UK learning anything in this process? And the only thing that Julie is already shaking her head. It seems like a very difficult learning process to take 2-3 years to decide to leave the European Union, negotiate, come up with an agreement, reject that agreement. Come up with new ideas, or come up with the idea that you can do something new. And actually, if you look at it, most of the questions that we're asking ourselves still today, we already had certain answers to even before the referendum. So, the most simple question, I know, Hugo, I've asked you this before. It seems to me when Boris Johnson says that, well, we're going to negotiate a better agreement than the one that we have, and if we cannot do that, then we leave without an agreement in a hard Brexit. First of all, what is the reason that makes Boris Johnson think that a better agreement can be negotiated? And there might be a lot of concerns about the agreement, but I think it all revolves, and that was also reflected in your speech, but also in the other presentations, it seems to revolve around the one core issue of the Irish backstop. And I asked you half a year ago, what is the likelihood that something will happen in the end of the process? That this whole package that has been renegotiated will be opened up again, and exactly on that one point concessions will be made. Half a year ago, you said, I don't think that's going to happen. I'm not sure if anything has changed in that. But still, since you know more about this than me, I'm always curious to ask that question. I think Larissa Bruna, the presentation was super interesting and also answered or actually asked a lot of the questions that I have. Why would the EU worry? I think that's a very, theoretically also a very interesting question that we need to ask ourselves. And I think you actually went in some very interesting directions to answer that question, because that's something that from my perspective, as somebody who studies the EU, is very interesting to understand what is actually at stake for the European Union. I think that's something that we should probably discuss a little bit more in this context. I think I will actually stop here. I found Sam Lowe's presentation also super interesting, but I think I will actually see if some of those questions also come up with some of the other panelists. So I think I'll stop for now. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Maximilian. I'll ask you to register that question with you, Hugo, and maybe come back to it a bit later. I'll ask the panelists to continue. So, Henry, if you would, please. please take the floor.
Sure. Thanks so much for being in this great presentation. And I think that was really set us up for a good follow-up here. We talked, Hugo laid out where we've been, Sam, a bit where we're going from the UK's perspective, and then and Larissa helped to lay out a little bit of the theory of the EU case. So I think that I'll try and offer a few words about the US perspective, and then a couple thoughts about some of the things we raised in the other presentations, where we're going, and then perhaps some goals that I think are important for us to be thinking about together with Iceland and the United States, but also the other non-EU, non-involved countries. And I think just before going to that, just note with Max's point that this, the lack of change is rather striking. I've been doing this for 2 years, not as long as, but it's striking how little things advance, and we just keep going to the same pace. So the US policy has been mentioned a few times. We have a very clear set of objectives that are contradictory, but supportive and equally important. So maybe strike the contradictory part. So we want to maintain, it's important to maintain the global economic system, financial stability, have the minimal disruption in the transatlantic relationship, and that's both the commercial and security relationship. We want to preserve, as an objective, to have the Good Friday Agreement preserved, and also to have an agreement that's resulted that allows enough autonomy for the UK and the US to have a very ambitious free trade agreement. So those are, as people mentioned, we have obviously the political statements of our folks from Washington are very clear and supportive of the UK's position. But really, the bottom line is we are, it's a sovereign decision. We are on the outside, which makes it, we can say it's a sovereign decision between a sovereign nation to nations to decide. But, so what does that all mean? And which part, it's objectives based on a hypothetical situation that has not been agreed to. So I think that allows for the wiggle room that there is. But what does it really mean? It means that we want an orderly exit, or an orderly Brexit, whatever that means, and that is in what would be most in our interests, and that's why I think it's important to think about what is in our interest, the United States, and it's having a good agreement, and having an agreement, having something that goes forward. I think what's at stake, moving on, and Hugo mentioned a bit. I was glad to see you talk. It's trade is critical, but there are all the extradition and security and data sharing, which is related to data information sharing, which is related to border security and counterterrorism efforts. These are critically important, and they are where we think that our interests could be affected if we don't get it right. So I think it's important to look at not just the trade relationship when we're talking about what is the future, but to look at what is impacted in addition to the trade relationship. Where we're going, Sam laid out some of the trade side of things, but I think, again, I encourage we try and think about where are we going in 15, 10, 15, 20 years? What is the trilateral relationship, if you will, the London, Brussels, Washington relationship? What will that look like? And I think our goal is that it's more stable, it provides more prosperity, provides more security, provides more coordination, on big issues, as was mentioned, so that we can work on strategic rivals together, and so that we're not, so how do we head to that? That's a longer discussion, but that's where I think it's really important, and as an outsider, and this comes to the part of what can we do, I think that Iceland, Norway, US, Canada, Australia, we on the outside can say, all right, what does that look like, and how can we contribute, what can we do? I think it boils down to, have great ideas, I welcome them, but it's really, I think it's encouraged that the eyes on the prize for the negotiations, that there is more at stake than, again, domestic politics, but there is more at stake than domestic political infighting on whichever side of the channel. And what's at stake is what is our future going to be, whether it's on trade, whether it's on security, and whether it's on geopolitical future. I mean,
there's a lot at stake here, so we can encourage from the outside, just to keep that in mind. Will that solve things? Yeah, probably. I mean, that's could be one element. And I think another thing is we're not involved, and so we've offered, I think, all on the outside, I don't want to speak for other governments, offer how can we help, how can we contribute to making this orderly, to making this work. The offer is like, thanks, we'll call you. But I think it's getting to the point where we need to, it's critical for all of us who are involved, but without being in the negotiation, to say, what is at stake, how our interests are affected. And that is a message that we can give to London, to Brussels, and I think it can have an impact. So finally, just on the goals, I think that our goals should be from the, you know, looking again from the outside, is that how can we have the UK-EU relationship eventually be one that allows us, the community of nations that we're talking about here, be able to work on the big issues better together. And I think that they're try and look at it with the glass half full. What are the opportunities of a new model? So these are just some of the things that we're thinking about here and there. Thanks.
Thank you, Henry. And Julie, may I ask you to make a few comments?
Thank you very much. I noticed that the panel, so the three of us who are panelists as opposed to the three speakers, in many ways can be seen as a panel of outsiders. Because the United Kingdom, in many ways, has always been an outsider. We deliberately stayed outside of the European Economic Community in the 1950s and 60s. We were then kept out for a while by General de Gaulle. But even after joining in 1973, there's always been a little bit of a sense of distance and of not quite being sure what our European future is. But I'd like to start by thanking Sam for making me do something that I didn't think was possible anymore. And that was to laugh about the whole Brexit issue. The idea that you can read a Scandi Noir novel and then have an analogy to Brexit, I thought was brilliant. So thank you very much indeed. My only experience of reading an Icelandic novel was one given to me by Johanna. I'm afraid I can't remember its name.
I can't remember either.
It's about a woman who was a drugs mule. And I was so engrossed in the book that I was reading it back on a flight, not from Iceland. I was reading it, I got back to Heathrow Airport, I was going through passport control. I was so absorbed in the book that I missed the electronic passport control and ended up standing in line to show my passport. And the woman behind the counter glared at me and said, "Where have you come from?" I was actually flying in from Oslo. But I was so wrapped up in the book about the drugs mule who kept flying back into Reykjavik that I said, "I'd come from Iceland." And the woman looked at me, "Where have you come from?" And I started to get my ticket out. I said, "Oh, no, I've come from Oslo." And she looked at me again, "Show me your ticket." And as a British citizen since birth and a member of the House of Lords, I was really quite cross with her and almost said the awful thing of, "Don't you know who I am?" But instead I just said, "Is there a particular reason for asking?" And she said, "There is, but I don't have to tell you." So I showed her my passport again, I showed her my ticket, and I went off feeling somewhat humiliated and rather stupid. So Scandi Noir can be a slightly dangerous thing to be reading. But at least it might take you away from the omnipresent issue of Brexit. And as Maximilian was saying, it seems in many ways that nothing has changed in the last 3 years. And at the same time, everything is changing constantly. That Hugo had to change his presentation today because of a decision by the Prime Minister persuading the Queen that she should prorogue Parliament. And I think one of the things about Brexit is that it puts all sorts of words into British political discourse, but also then must make life for translators and interpreters quite difficult as well, because prorogation is a slightly strange concept. But the intention is that there is a short break in Parliament. Shouldn't be an issue, shouldn't be a major problem, because it happens normally on an annual basis before a new Queen's speech at which a Prime Minister can state what he or she wants to do. But on this occasion, it seems it is about manipulating business, about stopping Parliament doing its normal business. And the former British Deputy Prime Minister Michael Heseltine yesterday wrote that a government which is frightened of Parliament is frightened of democracy. And one of the government whips in the House of Lords has resigned his position, so Conservative, saying of prorogation at this time that it risks undermining the fundamental role of Parliament at a critical time in our history. This is at a critical time in our history when the UK voted to take back control, claiming that the EU wasn't democratic. It seems a little bit strange then that the executive should seek to close down Parliament in order to execute something which it claims is the will of the people. So we're in a very odd position. And the biggest problem is that 3 years after the referendum, the answer to the question that Sam was meant to answer is still unanswerable. We don't know what the United Kingdom wants, because the United Kingdom remains not just as divided as it was in 2016, but even more divided, because the divisions that came to the fore in the referendum have been consolidated, they have become embedded, and they are visceral. And whereas Larissa, you see my face, sort of the eyebrows raising, not expecting much change, I think a Boris Johnson government, actively supported by somebody like John Redwood, potentially going to a general election, which they win on the basis of having delivered Brexit, will be a very different sort of government that will be looking to be a low tax government, will be looking to have a bonfire of regulations. It will be seeking to do what the passionate Brexiteers wanted to do in 2016. And I think it will diverge, not over time, but quite swiftly. So I think that is where we're likely to be in the next few months. Where the UK goes in the longer term is a much bigger question, because the country does remain deeply divided. And if that speculation is wrong, and there isn't a government of Boris Johnson and John Redwood, but rather a coalition of the Scottish National Party, the Labour Party and the Liberal Democrats, you will see something that is aspiring to have standards not just as high as the EU, but potentially higher standards. Because if you look at Scotland, it is a government and a country that does have high standards, is very keen on high social policy, and will probably be much more comfortable with the Scandinavian model than any Tory government would ever want. So I would say at the moment it's 50-50 whether we end up with the Johnsonite right-wing agenda or a certain more left-wing socialist social policy driven agenda. But we're likely to see profound change in the next weeks. Which way it goes is, I think, still a very open question. Thank you very much.
Thanks to the three panelists, and I would now like to ask the speakers, namely Hugo at least, and if the others have any reaction to the comments from the panelists, they should feel free to make quick and short comments. But I would like to abuse my role as a moderator and add on to Maximilian's question. And since we have Hugo here, your boss received a letter from the Prime Minister of the UK shortly after he assumed his position as Prime Minister. And in the letter, he lays out his vision as to how to move forward in terms of the agreement, the withdrawal agreement. And he says something to the effect that the backstop should be replaced by alternative arrangements. And then there's a paragraph, and if you allow me to quote. I'm sorry if I put you on the spot here, Hugo. I'm sure you've scrutinized this letter in detail. He says, "I also recognize that there will need to be a degree of confidence about what would happen if these arrangements were not all fully in place at the end of the period, the transition period." My question is there something there that is workable, you could work on with the UK government? find a way around the backstop, some kind of a legal guarantee that if you haven't found a solution for the backstop alternative arrangements, that you will do something else before the end of the transition period, or what might it even be we could be willing on the EU side to entertain the prolongation of a transition period in if that situation came up, or is this a non-starter? And talking about alternative arrangements, if I may direct one question to you also, Sam, I think that's within the remit of your expertise. How feasible are these alternative arrangements? How realistic or workable are these alternative arrangements? That is the name of the day for those that want to replace the backstop with something else. Can we, if I may ask you to very quickly respond to some of the comments from the panelists, and then I'll open up to questions from the audience.
Okay, thank you. I'll take the question and I'll turn to the arrangements. So alternative arrangements are the idea that you can find another way other than regulatory and customs integration to ensure that there is no physical infrastructure on the Irish border. It requires you to actually change the wording of the initial commitment, which was no physical infrastructure or associated checks. Because if you are to have alternative arrangements on the Irish border, there will be lots of checks. And all of the proposals for alternative arrangements all include lots of checks. They just don't include them, they don't have them as being literally on the border. They have them as being done away from the border and with facilities. So all proposals for alternative arrangements largely look the same. They also will run some sort of trusted trader scheme. Those trusted traders will submit import-export declarations to a digital hub. If there is, they will be run through a risk management system. If there is an issue, there will either be checks done on location, either at the point of export or the point of import, or they will be asked to stop off somewhere en route. That's fundamentally what all alternative arrangement proposals look like. And the question I always come back with is, what about the people who don't sign up for this scheme? How do you force people in the context of Northern Ireland who fundamentally object to any border, any economic border whatsoever, to sign up for and participate in a scheme they fundamentally disagree with? And the answer is policing. You start to increase the police presence, you increase stop and search, you increase raids on warehouse, and you make it to quite a hostile environment for traders who are breaking the rules. And then my supplementary question then is, why is this better than physical infrastructure? Because if the point of the backstop isn't to not have infrastructure, it's to not have infrastructure because you are trying to avoid a situation where you inflame tensions. I feel intrusive policing, stop and search, and everything that comes with that could be just as problematic as the alternative arrangements. And I think that's been completely lost in the British debate. And I should say I'm probably in a minority of about three in making this argument around alternative arrangements, Alan being one of the others. One of the other quickly interesting things that did come up was, because it came in two of the presentations about the services value added of goods, and the idea that actually you need to have strict controls on the UK's ability to diverge in some areas because of the impact having a competitive advantage on services could have on your goods trade. And I do quite a lot on services trade and also the interaction with goods. And I do have a question here, which is, if you think about the services interaction with goods, you have it in two ways. So you have the indirect, so if you're trading goods, you have the insurance, you have the marketing and the like. And when it comes to financial services, is the UK really going to diverge that much? I think under a John Redwood type government, it maybe would want to, but actually if you look at how the UK has behaved on financial services within the EU, we've pushed all the most stringent financial regulation. The Bank of England is a very tough regulator. We've gold-plated everything, and I just wonder where the divergence would go there. And then the other type of interaction with goods is that you have a package. So say you're a Boeing aeroplane, Boeing provides services to Norwegian Air, whereby they monitor all of the workings of Norwegian Air, and if there's a problem, they notice it at their data centre in the UK, they fly out an engineer who goes and works on it. So in the context of a Brexit where the UK is extricated in a sort of basic sort of free trade agreement, those services would still need to be provided from within the EU. They wouldn't be provided from the UK anymore. So I just wonder how much of a concern divergence in that sort of sense when it comes to services interaction with goods is really real, or just
just, you prompted me, Ambassador, to underline three times that, in fact, since we're getting into the politics of the backstop and what might happen, that everything I say is my totally personal opinion. I of course, I'm an informed observer, but at the end of the day, who's to say what will actually happen? How many people here actually know what the backstop is? Oh, okay, well, that's much better than I thought, but there's a hard rump up here that needs a little seminar, I think. Well, anyway, just for my own thinking, I just to be clear, the backstop is not... the first and most important thing to understand about the backstop is we never wanted it to cover the entire United Kingdom. The backstop is designed in our heads, on the EU side, as a Northern Ireland-only thing. And actually, what it is most important for in terms of traffic moving across that border, and I know members of my own family are directly involved, is agriculture. Do you know the drink Baileys?
Yes.
Baileys crosses the Irish border a couple of times to be made. The milk comes from my community in County Cavan, and it gets bottled up in Northern Ireland and it gets marketed down the south again. So the humble Irish sandwich, which I'm sure I know where Sam's office is in London, he probably goes to Pret a Manger sometimes. A lot of those sandwiches cross the Irish border twice to get made, and then another time, of course, to go over to the UK to feed the hungry Londoners. So what I'm trying to say there is, can you imagine checks on such a border a couple of times? It would ruin the agricultural industry, that's what I'm saying. It's integrated, and also would have a huge impact on the communities, because, you know, farming is a tiny, you saw the graphs, 1%, 2% elements of our economies. But it would destroy the local communities there because they, you know, farming's not just a job to make money, it's a kind of whole way of life. And also, Ambassador, you prompted me again to remind everybody that if the withdrawal agreement passes, there is a transition agreement attached to the withdrawal agreement, which means the UK stays in the single market in everything until 2020, and that transition period is renewable once. We don't specify more than that. So it means that Britain gets a chance to adjust after such a big change, after over 40 years' relationship with us. That's a big, big change for everybody. Obviously, it's in our interest too. But if we get a no-deal Brexit, that transition period evaporates. There is no transition period. And there's a bit of confusion about that in the UK because of the incorrect claims that, oh, but we can continue to trade on the basis of GATT 24, which is actually allows us to it's a standstill clause. And, you know, it's nothing of the sort. The previous UK government rejected it because the basically, as Sam can go into more detail if he wishes, is it's only if you have a free trade agreement pending with somebody that you have the standstill clause. So therefore, there won't be one. We'll be straight back talking about the withdrawal agreements because when we do start talking to each other again after no deal, you know, the EU side is quite likely to say, well, we're talking again, that's something. And the first three things we'd like to talk about are citizens' rights, your contributions to the budget, and the Northern Ireland backstop. So this is the approach that is more likely to emerge from a no-deal situation on our side, which means we just go round and round and round, and I know you're all dreadfully bored by that, because we are too. We would like to see it move on. The EU was ready to begin discussing the future relationship a year ago, and we hoped, based on the progress we were making at the beginning on the withdrawal agreement, which is very good, I'm going to speed up. I do think that the answer, and here it's really my personal opinion, I do think the answer probably lies in undoing that, Sam alluded to it too, undoing that big mistake, in my view, of extending the backstop to the whole of the UK, that the whole of the UK would be in the bare bones customs union with the EU, that the whole of the UK would have to do a sort of minimal regulatory alignment with the single market, because it was never designed for that. It was designed for that 300-kilometre border that's near my house. That's what the backstop was for. I actually, Britain has a right to go its own way, and we both agreed this was a special situation, and we don't want to lock the UK in if it doesn't want to be locked in. And I think that there was a comment by Carol Bilt this morning on Twitter I thought was quite good. Carol is never short of these pithy phrases, and he said, you know, the problem with why they won't get an agreement on the backstop is that the EU is fundamentally a convergence machine. That's true, we are fundamentally a convergence machine and standards setter. And Brexit is fundamentally a exercise in divergence. So we can't really get this philosophical, we're philosophically disadvantaged in finding an agreement. And where, to answer your specific question, does this little paragraph hold out a So hope. The problem there is we have a very different perspective on the backstop. From our point of view, and it says three times in our various things we've done with the UK to clarify, it is our earnest hope that the backstop never gets used. It's in the political declaration as well. The first thing we're going to do is sit down and talk about making sure the backstop never gets used, etc., etc. We've given those clarifications 100 times, and you might remember there have been so many chapters, as Maximilian said, that there was a big debate over whether those assurances were legally binding or not. And I think this is the problem then, is we want to know how such a promise would be legally justiciable or legally locked in, that we couldn't. You see how volatile, in a way, the volatility of UK politics, it shows the need for the backstop in the first place. Because, as was said, there could be a government elected tomorrow that wants the softest possible Brexit. And then there could be another one then, 2 months after that, that wants the hardest possible Brexit. Because the UK is in a volatile state, and that's fine. We all get our turn, by the way, to get laughed at by the world, or, you know, Ireland was there, everyone will be there, not going to mention a few years ago. You know, we all get a chance like that. So I'm not picking on the UK, I'm just saying that's the difficult situation. As it is, I just wanted to check up. The issue was kind of raised about what will the UK want to diverge on? And this is where it gets to the heart of Brexit. How was the EU holding the UK back in the first place? I mean, the UK, a question they often fail to answer on shows like James O'Brien's LBC, you know, show which I kind of watch when I want to restore my faith in humanity or listen to. And he always asks people, which is the European regulation that you want to get rid of? Which is the one that is holding this country fundamentally back? And they can, they can never really answer that clearly. For example, the UK is a world leader in artificial intelligence. Like, I would imagine that if someone was in a destructive relationship, a toxic relationship, you wouldn't have developed like a lead like that in a key area like that if the EU's regulatory system was somehow stifling your country. So maybe
I have an answer to that question.
You can join the EEA and then you can scrap the Birds and Habitats Directive and kill all of those newts that were stopping you from building houses, because the Birds and Habitats Directive doesn't apply to the EEA countries for some reason, because it's not considered market relevant. And people in the UK think if they can kill more newts, they can build more houses. It's not actually true, but they think maybe that would be enough to please people.
Thanks again. Time is really ticking. Larissa, you want to say anything, or can we open the floor to the audience?
Just really briefly. So the point I was making in my presentation was not so much whether any new government would want to diverge. And I absolutely see the point that a Boris Johnson government would very much like to do that, but rather whether it would be able to. And there, maybe I'm a little bit more optimistic, but I think really that's something that time will tell.
Okay, thanks, Larissa. I think I have permission to steal 10 minutes or so from the coffee break. So we will have a bit more time to get questions from the audience. I have a lot of follow-up questions, but I'm going to restrain myself and give others a chance. We have a question there. Do we need that?
Can I steal one?
Thank you. My name is Damien De George. I'm a Reykjavik-based EU Public Affairs Consultant and a board member of the Icelandic EU Trade Council. First, even if Boris Johnson is in office, about the no Brexit at all option, if closer to the deadline, the risk of chaos get more obvious in terms of national security for the UK. And second and finally, the word periphery was used at some point to describe the area where Iceland is. I'm not a big fan of the word, as it could lead to a misunderstanding about what is to be an EEA country in Iceland. Actually, if you talk the roaming directive, when you land in Keflavik with a Belgian mobile phone subscription, you're not saying in the SMS, welcome to periphery, but welcome to just another EEA country. Just like if you would be taking the train to Paris or London, and also when Norway, when energy is discussed in Brussels, I'm not sure that Norway is a periphery there. But I would either say it's a grey zone in Europe to be outside the EU
let's get a couple of more questions before I give the floor back to me.
I'm Michael Levin, the British ambassador. From the other side of the border from you, maybe our mothers met across that border. And of course, for Ireland, there's the advantage of the common travel area, so your mother is extra safe. Because I also think that the comment about nationals, EU nationals in the UK, from the beginning, I think the UK has been very clear that we want to protect those who live there. And indeed, we would argue that we are the ones who get pushing that, and even now we are still encouraging many EU countries to publish what they are going to do to protect rights. But I think what I'm struck also, you know, this is as has been reflected to a degree, a political motivation, the idea of freedoms. And we've talked a lot about trade, but of course, what interests me is if you look at the polling and the assessment which Professor John Curtis does, that despite nearly 3 years of debate, those who voted leave and those who voted remain haven't actually changed their mind. So you know, there's a question there about why is that, despite all the arguments that have been made, it still doesn't seem to have, I think the word it was entrenched views, and I think actually that from the polling it seems that there hasn't been a change in mind. And on, we could go on and on about the backstop, and I won't, but I just wonder whether on reflection the sequencing sort of set up the problem of the backstop. So withdrawal first, future relationship second. And in a sense, by doing that, we kind of created this problem. And maybe it's not for now, or maybe Sam could talk about it. But I'm interested in this comment, a bit of a passing comment about the future and US and Norway and Iceland and UK and Switzerland and what you meant about perhaps a new North Atlantic, perhaps, agreement.
Thank you, Michael. One more, and just one point on John Curtis. I also heard him, Professor Curtis, describe this in a way that the attitude in the UK now, it's even more polarized than before the referendum, and the curve in the polls is a U. So you have half of the nation, more or less, that is now even supporting hard Brexit or a loose relationship with the EU after the exit. And then you have a huge portion of the society that want to remain, but there's a relatively few that are in the middle, which are entertaining some kind of a soft Brexit. But that's another story.
Two more,
Okay, two more and then we'll give the
So my name is John. I'm a university student in the University of Iceland, and the 2016 referendum is being used as the mandate for leaving the EU currently by the Boris Johnson government. But in Switzerland, this April, I believe, the Supreme Court overturned a referendum in Switzerland on the grounds that the public had been misinformed on the issue of the referendum. But I was curious, since the Leave campaign in the UK have been convicted of breaking campaign's finance law and evidence of Russian interference in the election, and does that now delegitimize the referendum as a mandate for leaving the EU?
Yeah, thanks. My name's Ron McCarthy. I'm half Irish, incidentally, and my Irish family is from right between Michael's and Hugo's on the northern side, so I felt it was appropriate to butt in here. But I'm also a member of the Icelandic Parliament, and so
I'm interested in the observation. First off, just the phenomenal point that it's 1,161 days since the Brexit referendum, and it's 62 days until Halloween, right? So the fact that we don't seem to have progressed at all in terms of details, even though the landscape is quite fluid, is I think just astounding. The fact that we're still stuck there. But Sam raised a point that I really want to pick at a little bit, because I think it's actually crucial to Iceland's interests, which is we've been using the UK as an intermediary point for a lot of our trade for a long time, and as you pointed out, there's been probably very good arrangements made for most of it, but it seems that there hasn't been a complete tally of, I'm not even sure it's possible to make a complete tally of, the total amount of shift in trade flows of that type, and how that will impact each individual economy, for instance, in Iceland's case. I mean, shifting suppliers and places that deal with the fish is not free, right? And the question is there anywhere, anything that looks like an estimate of what the total impact just of the shift in that kind of flow would have on the region in the next couple of years?
Thank you. Let's give the floor back to the speakers and panelists. Anyone? One step. Please.
Can I maybe answer on the question of, yes, the referendum was in June of 2016. Yes, that is the mandate that Boris Johnson thinks he's using. But it is actually also the mandate that Theresa May function had, that the will of the people was expressed in an advisory referendum on that one date. And it has been taken as politically binding. And that was the view of almost all politicians before the referendum, that the result should be binding, even if that wasn't legally the case. In terms of whether some of the teams overspent, in terms of whether some of the claims couldn't be verified, I had a little bit of an altercation with John Curtis. I'm editing a book on referendums at the moment. I'm writing on the Brexit referendum, he was writing on the Scottish independence referendum. And I raised a question about veracity. And he said, but it's a bit illiberal of you, given that I'm a Liberal politician, it's a bit illiberal of you to want to be able to shoot things down that aren't necessarily verifiable. And I think there is a real problem, because even if it is the case that things were said in the referendum that were not true, if we had the results of the 2016 referendum struck down now legally, many of those people in the 50% that want a no deal or soft Brexit or some Brexit will cry foul. And so the damage that's been done to British politics will persist regardless of whether we respect that referendum or whether we have another referendum. The damage is done.
Anyone else?
Just briefly in answer to the ambassador for the question, what I was suggesting is just that there are a lot of hypotheticals. The trade is very complicated. The future relationship is not set. But there are a great number of issues, particularly foreign policy, security issues, sanctions, etc., that there's a great level of consensus. And the question I ask is, is the future relationship when the UK is out of it, is there room for greater geopolitical ambition through greater coordination with, again, like-minded countries that have more consensual view, whereas in the past, the UK and the US, when aligned, would, again, that was a, it was a we coordinated in how we influenced the EU's policy. That's how that was. Certainly, the United States policy was to work to influence the EU policy. That's our goal. Working with, could we, with Iceland, with others, with the UK as a non-EU nation, is that something we can work? I don't know that is a topic to discuss when in the midst of what's going on now, but all I'm saying is, when we're looking at 10, 15, 20 years down the road, what does that look like? Is there opportunity? Is there something we can work on in track two and track 1.5? Is there a way that we can think about having greater influence? Because that's ultimately, that's in each country's interest, you know, in a
particularly focused on the areas where we, again, have great levels of alignment. So building on this, the special relationship, working with the constellation of countries that also are have a lot of agreement with us on these issues, what does that look like? Again, I think it's peripheral to the now till October 31st conversation. It's not peripheral to what really matters.
Thank you.
Should I follow up with a few words on the? I think the question of, the referendum and interference and all that. I think that was very interesting. I think that's a discussion that was actually going on for quite a while. I mean, not necessarily about the aspect of outside interference, but just simply about the question of how was the referendum question phrased. I mean, were people given enough information to make that kind of decision? Because, I mean, it was basically a simple question of do you want the UK to leave or do you want it to remain? And it was nothing about the conditions. And I think, Julie, I think you can probably tell us a lot about the idea of a popular vote as a way out of this, but I completely agree with you. I mean, when the referendum question was phrased and when the referendum was held, the damage was essentially done. And, I mean, of course, you can say a lot also in terms of democratic theory about the advantages and disadvantages of referendums compared to other democratic innovations. I mean, should we have more deliberation about this? Or, I mean, you can make a lot of points about, I mean, is it really true that if you conduct a referendum that it actually leads to enlightened debate? I don't think there's a lot that points in that direction in this case. I think the interesting question is much rather, I mean, what do you do with this particular outcome? And again, I mean there are, come back to the question that I was asking Hugo before, and actually also the other ones. I mean, I can sympathize to some extent with Theresa May's position as somebody who had been in the Remain camp, but then basically had to deliver something that she didn't want in the first place. In the case of Boris Johnson, I'm actually wondering more, when he makes the argument that, I mean, a better agreement is possible, is this something that he genuinely believes, or is it just kind of some kind of diversion tactic or something like this? So this is not something that I'm very clear about, but I would actually, I know it's 3:10, so we shouldn't actually open up for too many more points, but I think it's a very interesting question.
Well, I'm sure there will be some scope to discuss some of these questions in the next segment on the institutional framework, and there are some overlapping issues here. Sam, you want to say a few words before we sort of start to draw this to a close?
So on the question of what does Boris Johnson want, fundamentally, above all else, Boris Johnson wants to be Prime Minister, and he wants to remain Prime Minister, and every action he takes will flow from that, and at some point that might lead him into conflict with some of his advisers, for whom their objectives are not in alignment. Boris Johnson is a useful tool towards delivering something else. In the case of Dominic Cummings, one of his most infamous advisers, is about Brexit and the rupture of the British state and the renewal of the British state. Maybe not in alignment. And I think we do need to, there's a lot of noise in Brexit, but we do have to fundamentally remember that there are only three outcomes. No deal, remain, deal. At some point that decision does have to be made. And when it comes to no deal and Boris Johnson, I do find myself wondering if he wants to go down in history, and he cares very much about how he will be perceived in history. If he wants to go down in history as the Prime Minister who delivered no deal. Because if he does have the fear that the warnings could be as bad as people say they are, he will be in two minds about that. And I do think we do have to take that into account. Take into account that everything he is saying publicly right now is not necessarily about the negotiation with the EU, but rather about positioning himself ready to win a general election that is probably going to come very soon. And I think that's important. On one of the comments, the word periphery was one I used, and as soon as I used it, I knew that I maybe shouldn't. You should know that I don't mean it in a pejorative sense. I would actually include the UK in the movement it's making now. It's still in the UK, in the EU's sphere of influence, but it's moving to a wider berth. And I would include the UK in periphery when I'm talking about that. I tend to think of the EU in terms of concentric circles. You have Eurozone, EU, EEA, then you have Turkey, the DCFTAs. As you move out on that, you move towards the periphery. So it wasn't a pejorative comment about Iceland.
I'll be very, very fast. I just wanted to address the UK ambassador's point about perhaps the problem with the backstop all along was the sequencing. And I think it's fair to point that out, because of course the key with the the backstop is that it's really a proxy. The debate over it is a proxy. It's not really about Northern Ireland. I don't think anybody wants Northern Ireland to go back to political instability. It's a proxy for the question of Brexit, which is, what kind of country does Britain want to be after it leaves the European Union? And in a way, what you're saying, and I think it's a legitimate point, is that those are the questions about the future relationship. And therefore, putting them into the withdrawal agreement was a recipe for trouble. But it's not just it wasn't just about what kind of country Britain wants to be after Brexit. It was, well, if that's going to mean it destabilised Northern Ireland anyway, it's anyway bad news. I.e., there is a radical plan. There's quite a clearly radical plan for Britain's future with the current leadership in the UK. And I wonder when we will, the public at large will become aware of that. Nonetheless, one little point I did want to make on the backstop is that, you know, we are also trying to think creatively at the moment. We respect Britain is going, as for the next 30 days, will be thinking how to fix this problem. And when they come back to us, I must say Boris Johnson's letter did worry us a little bit with some of the language, because it seemed to suggest we won't get very original ideas. One idea that's floating around Brussels, also we are not desperate but extremely concerned, is it possible to have some kind of farm union for the country, a one SPSS zone, where that takes away 70% of the problem immediately, and then we can get to trusted traveller schemes and other fancy things, because you can do that with services. So we are also, all I'm trying to say is we still hope, it might be a difficult, forlorn hope, that the withdrawal agreement will be ratified, because it's the best chance for an orderly Brexit, and we hope we can reach agreement with Britain on that. And there'll be a special place in heaven to the person who can fix that.
I think these are excellent final words for this segment, and I would just like to add that I think the excellent discussions we've had here in this segment, and for which I'm very grateful to you, both the panelists and the speakers, and you in the audience, that if there is a soft Brexit, and let's hope there will be a soft Brexit with a deal, Brexit is only beginning, because it is the future relationship that remains to be defined and negotiated. Now, if there is a hard Brexit without a deal, that question is even more urgent and more complex and difficult. So either way, we are just beginning this process, actually. And either way, it will have direct and indirect implications for Iceland's interests. We have based our trade and economic relations on the EEA for 25 years. And the UK is leaving the EEA. So we also, like along with Norway and Liechtenstein, need to redefine our future relationship with the United Kingdom, and the United Kingdom is an enormous fish in our small pond. We may be a small fish in the UK's pond, but the UK is the second biggest trading partner for Iceland. So this is a huge issue for Iceland and an absolute priority for our government. Thank you very much, and we have a 15-minute coffee break, and after that, Johanna will take over within a second. Thank you very much.